Here we are at Game Kastle. We are going to be talking with Ray, and it is going to be awesome. Game Kastle. Here is their logo.
Hey everybody, Edo here, and I am excited today because I am here with Ray Wisneski.
That's it.
GM for Game Kastle.
That's right.
And Game Kastle is my local store in Mountain View, but you have three locations, right?
Three locations in the Bay Area.
Yeah, which is awesome. Fremont, Mountain View, and Santa Clara.
Santa Clara, that's right.
And this was actually a video I've been wanting to do for a while because I've been talking to different folks from the industry, distributors, designers, publishers,
right.
But I hadn't actually gotten to talk to a retailer, which I really want to do, and I want to talk to some more, but I'm going to fill this video at different times with some B-roll of the store coming in. This is a great location. You can't see it much here, but I'll get some B-roll for that.
This is the Mountain View location.
This is the Mountain View location, which has an absolutely gigantic play space. You know, pretty small retail. So actually, I guess it's not that small.
It's actually pretty big.
It's pretty big, but just an awesome, awesome location. But, so, to get started, I believe Game Kastle was founded in, you said, 2003?
That is correct. We've been in business for 15 years now.
That is amazing. And so, you know, what's the origin story? How did you guys, or whoever was involved, decide to make a game store?
So, the short of the story, of course it's going to be longer than that, is that back in 2003, the owner of Game Kastle, before it was Game Kastle, just did an online business. And all he sold was like pretty much just role-playing games and some board games and what have you. And I was one of his customers. And there was one point in time where I got the wrong book. And so I don't know how much of a gamer you are, but I know that a lot of our customers, as being gamers, they always want their product yesterday. And yeah. So I was like that at the time. And so I called up and I said, hey, I had this problem. You know, can I get this fixed? And he's all like, oh, sure, I'll send you a new one. I'm like, is there any way I can come to your warehouse and get it from you?
We're playing this afternoon.
That's right, exactly. And he made an arrangement with me, and I went down to meet him, and we just got to talking, and I was like, you know what? This area right now in the San Francisco Bay Area could really use another game store, a really good game store. Have you considered doing that? And he was like, I have, and I have a spot. It's just I don't have the time to do it myself. And so I got to talking with him, and I said, well, you know what? I could put in the time. I had a full-time gig. And I said, well, I'll work nights and weekends if you want to try to get this going. And that's more or less how we got it started.
Awesome. It is your full-time gig now, right?
Oh, yeah. I would say more than full-time. Yeah. But
awesome. Well, and so 15 years is a long time. Mm-hmm. You started with your first store. And presumably that was a lot of the product that he already had in the warehouse.
Yep.
At that time, was it then predominantly role-playing? You know, when did you start picking up more of the board game? Like, how would you say, if you could just quickly sort of, through the years, how has the store evolved in terms of its offerings?
Sure. So it was, so we were like a hole-in-the-wall location. We were hidden behind a gas station. So we were definitely a destination location. But we just started with the bare minimums. You know, we knew D&D was popular, so we stocked D&D. We knew Sailors of Catan was popular, so we stocked certain board games. And then we started slowly getting into the miniature games. And there's certain products that you realize are necessities for a retail store. And that's where you have to do Magic. You have to do 40K. And then just start to learn the industry. Start to see what customers are asking for, you know, not just one customer, but like the bulk of customers. You hear a title that people keep asking for, look into it and see if you can get it.
Right. And so a big part of you as a retailer figuring out your inventory is just understanding the demand from the user base that who want to come to the store, what they're looking to play and buy.
100%. Because every location is going to be different.
Right.
With our three stores alone, each one has a different personality and a different customer base. And we, you know, there's one where Pokemon is huge and another where Magic is huge. And then with the other one, it's another game that's going to be huge for those locations. And so you cater to the community in that area.
Right. And actually, one of the things that you guys, now I've never, I've been in the Fremont location once, but not as much as these other two, but you are, as an organization, very active with tournaments and events and the Pokemon pre-order, whatever those are, and
yep.
Magic Night, and so...
Proto-spiels.
Yeah, the Proto-spiels are always here. And you have, in this space, there's some setup over there, I'll get some film of it, but the big... I don't know if that's 40K or some other game, but the big set pieces for the miniature games. How was that? Did you start those events in the beginning, or have you adopted them over time? How did that sort of play out?
You have to adopt it over time. You do a little bit at a time, and you grow over the years. Right. And with a lot of the tables and the specialized tables, I should say, for doing the miniatures and what have you. A lot of that either we built ourselves over time, or we had customers who built them or donated them, or we found them somewhere cheap. And we just, over time, we started collecting those and collecting the terrain that people use for the miniature games and trying to just make the place more inviting over time.
And you guys have even, beyond what I would say is what I see from a lot of game stores, you have the paints are behind us, but and the really cool chairs with the, I like the logo on the chairs. But you have a painting class, that there's the side room that you rent out, but you also have the painting class in there.
Yep.
Who was telling me, I think it was, I want to say Daryl was his name, was saying about you have this like RPG role-playing dinner night event thing.
Yeah.
How do those more elaborate setups come about? When did you decide to do those things?
Well, those came about once we got this location, which, as you guys will see, it is a huge location. So we had a lot of extra space to play with. And so for this location specifically, we really wanted it to be more of a hobby event center. So it was more than just playing games, but we wanted to offer services like our painting stations, where you can rent the area. We supply you some paints, and you have an area where you can just sit down and work on your miniatures. We have a back room that's dedicated either for privacy, for private events, or for teaching classes, like you mentioned. And we've been getting some really good quality instructors from all over the Bay Area to come in and teach people how to paint their minis.
Yeah, and it's super cool. And I've actually rented that room out just for sort of like an Edo game day with a lot of local friends, and it was great. One of the things I'll note, we're here, it's like Saturday morning, 10:15, which is the best time to film because it's quieter.
Yeah.
But and when I show footage, it'll seem like a bunch of empty tables. But when this at night, during the day, you know, this is a full room when you guys are doing events.
Yeah.
It is loud, noisy, and packed.
Yeah, this is actually, if you think this is busy, this is actually, right now is a quiet time for us. We only have one big event going. We have like a Warhammer Fantasy event going. Yeah. But it fills up quick.
It does. So along the lines, you're listening to the feedback from the people in the community, you're building out the industry. Let's just to building out your store offerings to move to some of the industry stuff. Presumably, you get the bulk of your game from distributors.
Absolutely.
Do you have a specific distributor? Like, are you able to talk about who your key distributors are?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We primarily use Alliance, ACD, PhD, and Golden Distribution.
So that's pretty much... That's most of the big distributors in the board game space. From your perspective, when you're considering a distributor or using a distributor, is it about their customer service? Is it about the games they offer and what your audience wants? Is it about how they how their customers? I think I said that, but just what do you think about when it comes to a distributor? Like, what's important to you as a retailer?
Well, I know for me, because I do all the ordering for all the stores, having a good rep is always important. But most of the time, it has less to do with the rep and more to do with what product they offer and the prices they offer it at. So, for example, Alliance, as you may or may not know, has an exclusive with Asmodee North America, which means all your Fantasy Flight games, which are extremely popular, that's the only location you can get it through. Also, they are the only distributor for WizKids games. So, with your HeroClix or Dice Masters, that's the only place you can get them from. Now, with the other ones, sometimes, like for Golden Distribution, for example, the reason we like them is because they have a lot of exclusive miniature lines that none of the other distributors carry. So it's kind of a mix mash, and it's picking the ones you really want to work with, because at a certain point, you can't have too many distributors because you have certain minimums you need to hit. To get an order put out, especially if you want the free shipping, which we always go for. Yeah.
Interesting. So, and then when it comes to publishers, at this point, are you, because publishers, many of which are dealing directly with distributors who then deal with you guys, but there are some publishers that are trying to get out, whether from Kickstarter and otherwise, will you look at buying from individual publishers, or do you always work with distributors? How do you see the publisher side?
So, I would love to say that we'll take any publisher and bring them on, but it becomes an accounting nightmare.
Right.
And so our preference is always that if you go through a distributor, then we will totally consider carrying your game. But I'm not to say that we haven't made exceptions. We've definitely made exceptions, especially to we like supporting our local game designers. So I know that
I'm in distribution, but
yeah.
I know there's some other ones.
Yeah, but some of the other ones we've made exceptions just for that reason alone. But preferences, I would say that if you're a retailer out there and you're just getting into this and you want to know what's best, do what's best for you. I mean, because if you can find a title that other stores aren't carrying just for that reason because they can't get through distribution, but you think it's going to do really well in your store, go for it. But realize that that's, you know, another person you have to deal with for ordering. It's another invoicing and accounting that you have to bring into, you know, your business model.
It's interesting. That's something that I've been facing, not in with distributors and publishers, but thinking about localization deals for different games. And when it's like, well, do you want to do one for Spain and one for Germany and one for China, and so you're like, I don't want to deal with all those contracts, all those invoices, all those relationships. It's just a lot, and you're like, I just like one solution for all of it.
Yeah.
So,
and that actually brings up a really good point, you know, especially if you're dealing with any publishers who are overseas, because then there could be, you know, extra shipping fees or the length of time it takes to get to your store can be a greater amount of time. So definitely things you want to consider.
And so, just one of the other big conversations going on right now, right, and I sort of alluded to it, is Kickstarter. And
yeah.
So being somebody who has, that GameCastle has been here longer than Kickstarter has, and you've obviously been able to see it being introduced in the impact, how do you, as a retailer, how do you look at Kickstarter? Is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? What has been the impact to your business?
So as far as Kickstarter as a whole, I think it's a mixed bag, right? There's definitely good and bad with it. But what I've found is, in general, even if a game is huge on Kickstarter, it does $3 million, what have you, all it really means is if we get that item in, it still sells hot in the stores.
Right.
As far as like whether, as a retailer, whether we support Kickstarters directly, we do make exceptions, but our general thumb is we don't touch it, again, because it's an accounting nightmare, especially with Kickstarter, because you don't have exact dates of when things are coming. You have to track all these emails to get the updates for all these different product lines. And I know that, like, just even regular gamers out there, I know that if you guys do Kickstarter a lot, you know that if you're backing a lot of games, I know I do personally, just tracking your updates just for those games can be a time sink sometimes.
So, to say it differently, from your perspective, when Kickstarter feeds the typical funnel of getting the games made and then into distribution, and then that's great for you. Where it struggles is when it's like, you're not going to go into a Kickstarter as a store and buy 6 copies, having to put out the money, or just not even knowing when they're going to come out.
Yeah. Or even knowing if the game's going to be good, right? I mean, the game can look really good, you know, on the page, but you know, when you actually get it, it may not be as good. But that being said, it's still something that, you know, you just have to be careful about. Because lots of times what happens is you'll get a customer who comes in the store and they're really excited about this Kickstarter and like, hey, are you guys going to do this Kickstarter? And it's like, that's one of like 100 customers who might ask me that same question about 100 different games, and it's like, well, we can't carry that many games.
Right.
So you got to choose your battles.
And certainly I guess along that can't carry that many games, the other thing that's happening in the industry right now is this explosion of titles.
Oh my goodness.
Both in the Kickstarter route, but just from other publishers, and the quality level's going up, the art quality is going up.
Production value,
How are you dealing with the volume?
It's a real task, because it used to be where, you know, just to fill our shelves, you know, we had to say, okay, we're going to carry this game, you know, this, every single Rio Grande title, and we'll put it on the shelf. But now it's like, okay, we're only going to carry the best sellers of this publisher and then of this publisher. So you really got to pick and choose, because there are so many games that are so great right now, which is great. It's an exciting time in the industry.
Yeah, and in some ways, the pinch there is being felt on the publishers and even some of the traditional publishers, because they can't be like, you're going to take every Asmodee title.
Yeah.
You're like, well, hold on a second.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, you know, I mean, this has been a great conversation. You know, I guess the last thing I might ask you, and then the quote would be, for somebody that lives in an area without a game store or just really wants to do it, you know, what would be some key advice you might give? You mentioned a few points earlier to somebody who really just wants to start a board game store.
Okay,
or
so
role playing or anything, game store.
Yeah, so I have actually some really good advice there. One is, don't worry about the location too much. Get a location that you are comfortable with. Because most gamers, they will find you. Don't worry about advertising too much. Get as much free advertising as you can. Put flyers out at local conventions if there are some. Otherwise, get on the internet. Create a Facebook page. Just get the word out that you're there. Do as much free advertising as you can, but don't invest the extra money. The other thing is, don't feel like you have to please everybody, because in trying to please everybody, you're still gonna not please some people. Don't short yourself feeling like you have to put product on sale just to get people's business. Try to create a gaming community, an environment that gamers will truly love, and they will come and they will support you. And if you're really, really interested in starting your own game store, I don't know if you're aware of this, but
I don't even know what you're gonna say.
Game Kastle is now going to start franchising stores. If you go to our website and you go up in the top there, you can search, and there's information on if you are interested or know somebody who's interested, you can now consider Game Kastle. In our experience, our 15 years of experience, and we can get you set up. We have our own database, and you can use my wealth of knowledge if you have questions about which products to carry, and we'll get you started.
Well, that's awesome.
It's pretty exciting.
And certainly from my experience, again, I haven't been to every game store in the world, but I've always been impressed with you guys and how you've taken it. In this location, I really love the open space of it. And it's been an awesome place to have to game and do stuff. So awesome. And awesome, they're franchising. That's news. I had not known that. Cool, man. Well, thanks for being on.
Hey, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Hey, everybody. Edo here. And thanks for watching Gaming with Edo. Reviews over here on this playlist, League, and Insider videos over here on this one. Subscribe, share, all that good stuff, but most importantly, play some great games. Thanks.